Our next few speakers, who I know very well. First one is in the middle, Coach Doug Wilkins. Michael O'Brien will bring his experience as well, but Coach has been a football coach for 46 years, a head coach for 44 years, high school principal for 13 years. And I want to talk a little bit about where he coached. He coached at a small public school where Michael O'Brien and I went to high school together and played for Coach in 1996. Being at a small public school, we really couldn't control what kind of talent showed up. We only had, when we were there, I think it was 120 kids. So pretty gender even, 60 boys, 60 young men. And from that, he had to turn out a tremendous team every year. He wasn't going to wait for great talent to walk in the door. He was going to make the most of his team. So we talked before about unlocking the potential of your team. This is what it's about, unlocking that potential, finding the most. You know, we all have kind of firm mantras and lines and sayings. And Coach can figure out how to get the most out of every single player. I mean, we had kids on our team, I remember, Andrew Wilkinson, a little friend on the team who was on the chess club. He said he wanted to play football. And he showed up and he was committed. He was out, he didn't have the raw athletic ability, he didn't have the size, he didn't have the weight and the strength. But he showed up and he was committed. Coach made him successful. I remember my senior year, he blocked a field goal that put us into the championship game. He dove, and it was unbelievable. Because he followed, because he was committed, and we were committed to him. We had students on the team. We had that were hearing impaired. It was happened to be have a relationship with the only hearing impaired, one of the two or three hearing impaired schools in New Jersey. And we had one of the students who said, "I want to play football." And he was very successful. Now he couldn't play on the offensive line, so he couldn't hear the snap count, but he was very good on defense. Very good. And he showed up, and I can't see, he lived very far away, so we didn't really see him too much socially, but he was committed and he was successful. So when I tried to frame the room for Coach, Coach has got a lot of the secret sauce, Coach Wilkins. But I wanted to say, you know, how do I think about this room? How should you think about everybody here? I said, think about this room as you're sitting in front of all the captains of every 44 of those teams, the captain, the 88 individuals, these captains. They're all committed, they've all signed up. But now they're coaches themselves, and they're 10 years into running their own teams. And they're trying to figure out, what do I do? What are those best practices? How can I get to the next level? How can I not only bring the horse to water, but bring them thirsty, which is one of my favorite quotes that you have. Only told us many years after we left the team. So that's Coach Wilkins, and I feel honored to have him and his wife here today with us. The other two gentlemen are Michael Catafo and Brian Panaleo. They'll introduce themselves with a couple things. I'll say a few things they won't say about themselves. In addition to being my two best friends, Brian is a lights-out public speaker, in addition to being a counselor. An attorney, I call him counsel all the time. I say my counsel. And I always travel with local counsel and general counsel, so it's good. It's helpful. But
Spencer, your sixth grade art teacher is in this room.
And yeah.
He's not happy with your drawing. And that's not a joke. She's actually in this room.
So anyway, that's Michael's mother who came to the room because our families are important. My mother's here as well. Because they want to say, what are you guys spending all this time on? What are you doing? So you guys can show up and sit in the back of the room. And you guys can meet them at the cocktail hour later. But so Brian, the lights out speaker, was the best man at my wedding. And blew everybody's socks off. Michael is probably signed up for Coach's mantra better than anyone else I've ever seen. Michael went to the Naval Academy, played Division I lacrosse for 2 years, and then he quit. So, Mike, why are you quitting the team? He said, they're not really committed enough for me. Use some other vulgarities that I shout repeat in this room, but So Michael, you're in a division, our Division I lacrosse team. You're probably going to start next year. It's a military academy. These people aren't committed enough to you, for you? He goes, no, not at all. And that's the bar that was set. And Mike has gone on to, you know, start a 150-person sales organization at a solar power company, one of the few that is still, you know, charging ahead and doing extremely well. He left there to run a tech company and recently had a very successful exit. And has now launched Squash, which he'll tell you just a minute or two about, because I don't think I can do it full justice. But now I'm going to sit down, before I do, leave you with just two key takeaways. And two key takeaways, there's so much to talk about leadership. We're going to focus on two things: unlocking your team's potential and succession planning. So with that, thank you all. Thank you, Mike, for flying from California. Thank you, Brian, from Florida. Thank you, Coach, for being here. I really appreciate all the time and preparation you put in for my colleagues and friends here. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that introduction. I think I'm going to take this very public moment on behalf of Mike and myself. Thank you, Coach, for all the things that you taught us. Hard work, values, setting a standard of excellence for yourself. And I think we could have a whole conference about that today. These are things that we could talk about all day long, but most likely, everybody in this room knows about this. I mean, this is a leadership conference on Sunday. Everybody's here. Everybody's here to try and, you know, learn. So I think it's just a baseline, and Coach, I just want to turn it over to you, and so you can talk about the common denominator.
What these guys didn't tell you is these guys, I coach pampered suburbanites. You don't think that's a job. And their parents I had to coach. It's a thrill to be here. I'm a little nervous with the caliber of people that are here and the speakers that I've been introduced to and so forth. And you're all sitting there, a football coach, you're like, what are you doing here? And I think, I believe, you know, we're doing a lot of the same things, and that's why I started out here with the common denominators. What we're trying to do is maximize the potential of the people that we're dealing with. And that was my role for 44 years, to maximize the potential, you know, of every player that was in the program. And I think the other thing that jumped out to me that we have in common, that we deal with teams. The type of business you're in, you're dealing not only with teams within your organization, but you're going out and having to create teams for the people that you don't know. And that's what I did. Every year, it's a new team. And I don't care if half the team was coming back, it's still a new team. It's like dating a new girl. You gotta find a different approach. You know, the same approach that you had with the old one. So I think there's a lot of things in common here. I think that one of the things that I felt very strongly about over the years here as we've gone through this is that I always had the perspective, and I think. You know, as I listen to the people up here, the group before me, you know, the thing you have to remember, and I always have to remember, I'm not the one that's going to go out and be throwing the football or making the tackles or making the blocks. I don't have to do that, but I have to have the group that I'm working with, they've got to be ready to do that. And so I have to find a way to get them motivated and get them on board to what I'm doing. So I think that is one of the key things in terms of, you know, they were going to walk in and they look at me and, okay, like, what do you got for me, Coach? And I think all of you are in that situation too, that, okay, what do you got for me? You go, next day you go back to work, you know, what do you got for me here? And I too am so impressed that people are sitting here on a Sunday afternoon. It brings me back to the days when my poor wife was pregnant and had two little kids. And I'll say, I'll be back on Sunday night. You know, Friday afternoon I'd leave. and gone to Washington, going to Allentown, Pennsylvania, going to Elmsford, New York, wherever I could to sit down and listen to great coaches doing the same things I would, because that's how I felt I was going to get ahead, is to listen to the experts and listen to other people and how they try to do this. So I know what you're going through here. And you have my total respect for that. I want to touch on a couple of points here before I move on here, that all of you are leaders, and a couple of things that jump out to me as I talk about how I approach the team. I think number one, you need to be proactive rather than reactive. Many times I think people react to situations instead of being proactive and create situations that they then can handle and want to happen, rather than sit back and reacting. And I think that another thing to remember, in my business, it was very important, you have to stop losing before you can win. Look at what you're doing in your operation and get rid of those things that aren't healthy, that aren't productive. A lot of times I think, there's only a certain amount of energy and time to go around. And I find this, a lot of times people, they're not sure what to do. Well, stop doing the things that are causing you to fail or causing you to not be the best. I think another thing is that action is always better than non-action. Because I think when people are looking at a leader, they look upon you as a leader, and you want to be looked upon as a leader, they're looking for action. They're looking for, all right, what are you going to do? You're the person. You have the room. What are you going to do? And so I think that's an important concept. And finally here, I think that the key thing always for me is to find like-minded people. You don't have to convince everybody in the room. You don't have to win over everybody in the room. But I would spend enough time with my constituents that I get to know them, and I would try to find enough like-minded people, groups 5, 6, 7, and work on marshaling that strength. Because now then you're not one person, you're a group of people. I think that's another effective way to move teams ahead.
Coach, you used to meet with us at the end of each season and sit down and have an exit interview. And that was one of the most remarkable things. Can you tell us a little bit about those interviews?
Sure. At the end of the season, I would always, maybe we had, starting with the kids who were playing freshman football up through the graduating seniors, I'd sit down and have an individual conference with each kid. And it was really their conference, and I was trying to craft a couple of questions, not as good as the group before me does, but, because I wanted them to talk. And it's like, kids always, my experience is that they have all the right answers if you ask the right questions. And they'll tell you anything you need to know to make them better. And so I used to spend a lot of time just listening to kids. And the other thing I always did, I always had right in front of me their testing results on the tests that we gave kids. I had the report card in front of me. And so they knew that I was loaded there. I knew all about them. And sometimes you didn't have to open your mouth. Oh my God, he knows. So I just wanted to know, hey, I'm making it my business to find out about you, and I'm going to know the good things, and I'm going to go know the not so good things either. So that was the gist of these conferences, and I think this is where I try to get kids to understand, what goal setting was, what are your goals, what do you want to accomplish in this program, how are you treated in this program, what do you like, what do you dislike, now's your time to tell us. And so that was the gist, really, of those conferences.
Coach, when it comes to drive and motivation, Spencer talked about this earlier, there's the old adage, you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make him drink. And Spencer mentioned, you always talked about making the horse thirsty. And can you tell us a little bit more, explain what you mean by that?
Well, that's the whole idea. I mean, I as I always used to tell kids, I could make that horse drink. And they had to get a couple of roller coasters, and we'd grab that horse around the neck and stick his head under the water. Sooner or later, he'd kind of open his mouth and I'd have to take the dog. But you know, to do that twice a day, that's tiring. And you know, that's not how I want to spend my time. So the key is, you know, how do I make that horse thirsty? And that's your talent as a leader. How are you going to make that horse thirsty? And you know, there's no one answer, there's no easy answer. And I think what you have to do, as long as you are aware of it, and see, this is why I'm in the next slide up. Okay, following next slide. When I put this program together, to me, you know, as it says up there, the foundation is the key to any construction. And so I wanted to be, I felt that building a program just on talent is like I say there, like building on sand. You're taking your chances. I had to coach all the kids that walked through the door. I didn't get to go out and say, give me a tackle, give me a running back, I'll take a receiver. It's whoever showed up at the door. I had to coach those kids and produce a team, make them a team, number one, and hopefully win a lot of games. And so I felt I had to find something that was going to pull it together that I could use as my philosophy and my criteria if you want to be a football player at Mountain Lakes High School. Maybe you can put up the next slide. And this is what I came up with, the whole idea that everybody was going to be judged just on those two things, their attitude and their commitment to what our goal was to win every game. And I chose that because, number one, it's attainable for all. Anybody in the room can be good at either of those things. Anybody in the room. I'm not saying you're going to be talented. Hey, that's a bonus, I always thought I had to do. With these guys, I'd get a lot of talent. They were damn good football players, and so I think that's all it. Plus, the other thing that I like about it is that by using those two things, it's very measurable. So when I sat down with that kid, I could talk to him about his attitude and his commitment, and hey, the facts don't lie here.
If you're given the choice between a talented kid or a talented whiz kid, somebody who has the same philosophy that you do, who would you choose and why?
The kid who has the same philosophy, because I think that your chances for ongoing success are going to be much greater. And I think that, as I said, one or two talented kids, and even the pros find this, it's not going to get the job done. It's about the kid who's number 18th on the chart, or the kid who's number 20 on the chart. And the success is bigger, going to rely more on those kids than they are, you know. Because number one, if they're not creating holes for the great running back, he's not going to do anything. Watched LSU last night, and that guy who was averaging about 150 yards a game, he went nowhere. And so I think that's the whole idea. So certainly, and I think it perpetuates itself.
How do you show kids with the same philosophy that there's a place for them in your program?
You tell them. You explain to them what it takes to make it. This is what you need to do. And you know, I'll get very specific as I begin to counsel kids. This is what I see as your weaknesses. This is what I see as your strength. What do you think? You know, where are you on this here? And this is what you need to do, because we've always taken the approach that we're going to get every kid that does these things for us and stays in our program for 4 years. By the time you're a senior, we're going to make you a player. You're going to be on that field. And I think that's, you know, kids wanted to be part of it. And as they got involved in it, they wanted to be even more of a part of it. And I think the key thing is that, and I think something that you need to do all the time, and the group before mentioned it a couple of times, is that you have to somehow make every kid valuable. That kid, you have to assign value. My experience over 40-some years, that's all kids are looking for. They don't need to be out in the field playing necessarily. They don't need to be the star on the team. They just want to be assigned some value, not so much by me, but by the other team. Because to a kid at that age, there's nothing more important to him than a teammate. They're more valuable to him than a coach. When they're embraced by their teammates, it's just like the people you deal with. Hey, when everybody in the team lets them know, hey, what a good job. Man, you don't tell me, you know, it's like riding a wave. All of a sudden, you know, that just buoys you up. So this is the approach here.
How do you show kids that they have value?
Find something. You know, I heard a coach once said, hey, the kid gets his pants on, right? Compliment. Yeah, hopefully it's not that basic, but you got the idea. You know, find something, you know, where you can pat him on the back and you know, it's you know, as I conference kids, I mean, it's amazing. You know, like, and they would love when the older kids said something to him. If the kid just looked at him during the school day, he so-and-so looked at me, you know? I mean, it's not hard to find something where you're giving this kid, he feels valued, he's feeling a part. Maybe we can put up the next slide. Yeah. We've talked about that. Okay. The whole idea here, you know, people have that, Coach, why do you win every year? And it's very simply this, you know, we play winners. I'm not going to sit in a poker game and throw my money in and not having the cards. I mean, that's going to get old. You can only bluff so often here. So sooner or later, you've got to put up here. And I think that's what we did. See, our whole idea, I can find the most talented kids in a couple of days. I'll put them through a couple of drills, through a couple of things, and I can rank the first 10 kids in terms of their talent level to be a football player. But to find out their attitude and their commitment, I'm evaluating them 12 months a year over 4 years. Because it takes there's a lot of time equity involved. You got to sit down, you're going to follow kids. I go watch kids in other sports. I talk to other teachers about them, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So you begin to see, to find out who your winners are. Throw the next thing in. And you know, my feeling was always, you need to sell the kids, they need something to rally around. And something you can sell the kids. That's the start of bringing the group together. Next slide, please. I love this picture here. We have this hanging in our locker room. And I always look at that picture and I look at it and say, whoever had that, who got all those fish to be in the location that they're in? And notice how accepting they all are of what their role is here, because the goal they knew, somebody realized, or maybe they're just too dumb to realize, I don't know, but you know, they want to get that big fish, they were going to have to work tirelessly together here. And even the fish way up in the ass end of that fish there, those people have as much value as the people near the front. You know, they all have equal value here, and that's an important concept here. So a kid understands, hey, I'm as important as the tap up here. Okay, the next slide. And so our goal was always 12 and out. You know, we had 12 games, although when we started with these guys, we had 9 games, I'm not sure. But the idea that, hey, we want to win all our games. I mean, how do you stay in front of the group? Well, we want to do an okay job. You know, we want to kind of win most of our games. And as I told my wife, that heart surgeon that was going to cut open my chest, I didn't want him to look at me and say, yeah, we win most of our games. You know, the idea of being, hey, we're we're going to get a championship effort every year. And you know, it's this whole concept of dreaming the impossible dream. Because even if we don't get there, and I think it was, became head coach in 66, and my first undefeated team was in 1973. That's a long wait. But the idea, we came close a lot. We had several one-loss seasons. So the concept being, hey, you shoot high, you might not quite get there, but, you know, you're going to get close.
Coach, one of the things that just popped in my head, and I think it's something I want to talk to the group about, is this concept of selling. And one of the things that's become apparent to me over the years is you are really a master at selling. What do you think made you so good at doing that with the kids you're working with? Because I think that pertains to everybody in the room. If you're getting people to buy into what you're doing, you're constantly selling.
Well, that's why I think, you know, people often say, well, winning's not important. Well, winning was important to me because I had to win enough to know, because that's why kids are out there. If I had five season where we didn't win a game, then they're going to look at me like, why am I doing all of that? And the idea was, you know, that was the carrot. You know, hey, stick with me. You know, it gives me my credibility, and you know, they look at you in a different way because I get results. And that in itself is, you know, builds energy and so forth.
Talk about carrots. How about sticks? I mean, you're telling me a story at lunch today, actually, about like how you walk into the room in the first meeting. Do you remember?
Yeah, we'd always start, you know, the first day of practice, we'd have this big meeting down the middle school cafeteria, and it was intense. You know, we went there an hour and a half, kids had to know certain things, and the rule was you always had to obviously be on time, have a pencil, and have a notebook. You take notes in. My hope was that there's at least one kid who came in not prepared. So then I could just like put on my railing act and it's like, holy cow. And you know, I wanted them to see that side, and I wanted them to see how important that I placed on that, because it's the little things in a game that's going to determine your failure or your success. So right away, right out of the chute, I wanted to, well, that kid was not going to be happy when I was done with him. And what I usually did is the kid who made the offense, when we went out to practice, all the other kids ran. He stood in the middle. He didn't have to run. All the other kids did. The idea being that, hey, this is a team, and you know, we are all beholden to the actions of each other. I want to talk a little here about put up the picture of the geese before I get too far away. This again has been a hallmark of our program. The reason I like this is the fact that, I don't know how much you know about the bee formation and geese flying, but you know, it's like they can go 74% further if they fly in that formation. Look up in the sky. I saw one the other day. They're all in that formation. And notice the geese up front. That's the one, that's the toughest job, because he's breaking all the wind resistance, and then the other geese are all behind them. And they all take turns. And I often use that term with my kids. I'll say, it's your turn to fly the point. And you know, they know exactly what that means. I mean, look at those geese there. You look at their faces. Aren't those things look happy? Yeah, they're part of something. They know, hey, their job is just as important. And how if they work together, they're going to be able to do greater things.
Coach, I think this is the concept of creating this, particularly within a workplace, it's a work of art. And I think whether you're in a field or whether you're in an office somewhere, this is something that's very difficult and rarely achieved. How do you know when you have it? Like, what are some of the things that you're observing
I'll tell you exactly, and you can feel it. When I put a kid who had very little talent, a real sub maybe of the second level, third level, and I put him in a game, and all of a sudden he's making plays like, how the hell is he doing that? And you see how he's raised his level of performance because, you know, he's part of this group and he doesn't want to let anybody down. And, you know, it's so energizing.
Coach, you talk about striving for that friendship with the person above you. You know, the freshman striving for the senior striving for the coach, that your assistant's coach is, you know, striving for your friendship. I mean, can you expand on that a little bit?
Yeah, you know, I had this mentor, fortunately, early in my career, who was just a remarkable man. And he was one of these guys, I mean, he whenever I was with him, I mean, he would pepper me with questions, and I would drive him all over the East Coast to go to clinics and stuff. And, you know, you never say no to him. He did what he said. And I always felt that he was testing me to see if I was worthy. And once he felt I was worthy, he would sit down and, I mean, he knew more than anybody about the game of football itself. And I'll never forget the first meeting I was a freshman, just graduated from college. I got a job as a head freshman coach. And so I ran up to him and I wanted to sit down. I said, God, I got this job, I don't know what I'm doing. So I sat and talked with him about 3 hours. Not once did I take a note, or did he ever talk to me, you know, this play, this defense, and so forth. And it wasn't until years later that I began to realize what he was telling me. He was talking to me about all these types of things, which had no meaning to me at that point. You know, all the things that were going to lead to it. It's like, I can run any offense I want. I can run any defense I want. That has nothing to do with it. You know, as long as it's sound, as long as it's fundamentally sound, it's more the performance of your kids. Another question? You want me to go on?
Why did that? I bet you heard a lot at a lot of dinners. Why don't you throw the warm ball more?
Well, the easy answer, three things can happen, two of them are bad, so.
I mean, how important is it to be committed to your system, no matter what else, and the system being committed to it?
Well, that's the whole idea, is that I think you have to have a plan, as I think the one slide said there, and no matter what the plan is, you want to stick to it. You don't want to, love to play these teams. This year they're doing this, the next year they're doing something completely different. I used to love that. We did the same thing. The kids learned the same things as a freshman, they learned them as a senior. By the time they got to the senior year, they were starting to get a little bit. Because the whole concept again is we had to stop losing games before we could win them. And so we were a team, we didn't make a lot of mistakes. By mistakes, I mean a kid knowing what to do. That was a big one. And, you know, that was a big no-no in our program. Like, everybody had a certain, called them rules they had to learn. And I would question a kid, and I want the rule, and I want it word by word, you know. And you know, kids lived in fear that I was going to ask them. But it was this idea of the discipline of sitting down, and you felt it was important enough that you're going to sit down and learn it, and so you didn't let me down or let the team down. You know, part of this equation with these kids was, hey, I'm asking a lot of you, and I know that. This is hard. But understand this, that I'm giving myself to you. I'm always going to be there for you, and I'm going to do whatever I can to help you. That's why we were always a top-down program. That by the time a kid came a senior, like, we put a lot of responsibility and a lot of ownership in our seniors' hands, because kids responded to that. You know, rather than I used to tell people I could win every 3 years. I remake my team. I get a bunch of sophomores, put them out there, let them get pounded, and sooner or later they're going to get to learn and so forth. But what about the older kids on the team? The kids knew I was never going to sell out a kid. You did the work. You had the great attitude and commitment. You know, you're always going to be one of my guys. And even if the talent was close, Ty went to the older kid. And the kids knew that. And I've had kids, the one thing I remember, we had this back, Jake Perpuka. I mean, he could have played any position on our team. And he was just a great athlete and went off to Duke, was a great lacrosse player. And his junior year, he didn't start for us. I mean, he was better than the kid that was in there, but the kid was a senior. And he had worked for 4 years to be that starter. Now, I mean, he was good enough. And I'll never forget, it was one of the most heartwarming ones I had when I sat down at a conference with this kid, Jake. He says, "Coach, you don't even have to go into it." He says, "I get it. I understand why he's a starter." And, you know, that's, you know, you're accomplishing what you want to accomplish. You want to, because I said, you know, kids are telling you what you need to know.
You really use playing time in varsity letters as a way of giving people value, like you were saying before.
Well, that's it. The team on the field was a reflection of me and a reflection of the program. And I was never going to put a kid out there who had not earned that, or anybody who had embarrassed us. And we had very strict behavioral standards. And if the kid got in trouble at school, and if the kid went out and was drinking or something, it was automatic, you're off the team. No questions asked. We're not going to have a hearing. We're not going to do suspension. You're done. You can come out next year, and you start fresh. And but kids knew that they want standards. They want to know, all right, everybody knew the expectations. And if they followed these expectations, because that's the one thing I have to give kids is playing time. I can control that. Because I often tell a kid, hey, you're going to be standing next to me during games. And I would make sure I was playing the kids. And I've had kids come up and tell me, "Gee, why is so-and-so playing?" And I had a kid one time tell me, "Hey, Coach, you forgot about the good kids." And you know what? He was right. And I knew I had to slap myself side the head and say, "You better get back to, you know, what you believe." Because I think you have to have a philosophy and a belief on how, what you want to build, how you want to build it, and then you have to stick to it, you know, through thick and thin. I don't care who's yelling and screaming at you. People would sit up in the stands, "How come this kid's playing? Who is not playing? This kid is much better than he is." Well, they don't get it. And that's not what the program is about.
Coach, in terms of details, I know you talked about this a little bit before. How did you even... You know, you talked about we had to stop losing. I think a lot of times leaders don't figure that part out first. Everybody focuses on the winning part. How did you even begin to start to look at things and break things down?
Well, I'll never forget this. I don't know why I remember, but I can remember one of my early years. And we weren't doing well. We didn't have a good season at all. I mean, we couldn't move the ball. We couldn't run any type of offense. I was so discouraged. And I made up my mind in the off-season, those days we had the old 16-millimeter films, and I had a projector. I sat in front of that projector for hours and hours and hours. I took every play that we ran that year, and I sat down and evaluated every play. And the question I asked, why did this play fail? Because I wanted to know, what is not connecting here? And the one thing I found was, the first step that we took, like in the offensive line, we weren't taking the correct first step. That's the last time I ever made that. That had that problem. And anybody who played for me, they know that, and they go nuts. Because, you know, it's always, you know, they sprint down a board, I would say they just aren't doing this. They're left foot first, right foot first. And they had a step. We just stand and step, practice our stepping. We didn't even run a play, just practice our stepping. Because even if they stepped in properly, they might be a great blocker, but they're going to be out of position. So the point being, it's the littlest detail. Do you have that picture of the dike? Yeah, I thought this was a great shot. It is, yeah, obviously, you know, I like visuals and stuff, and kids, you know, I'll ask, you know, what does that mean to you? What does that show? And the point I make here is that, you know, like these floods, when the dike gives way, how does it start? With the smallest hole. And then it gets bigger and bigger and bigger. And that's what happens to your program. If you don't take care of it and take care of the little things, you're not going to stand a chance. And so that was the lesson. You need to go back to that.
Doing the first step drill was tremendously boring. how do you get people to want to do boring things?
Well, that's, you know, in fact, I tell somebody that I did boring well. Can you imagine? I mean, they bored. Imagine how I am in my 40th year, I'm doing the same thing, and you know, it's like getting kids off the ball, ready, set, up one, up two. And you know, you can just say, well, why don't you blow a whistle? Because I want them to process the snap count, practice getting up quicker. So you just can't do it by a whistle. But if just a repetition, you come out and watch us practice on the first day in September, and you come out the day before Thanksgiving, we're doing the same things, the same drills. And I'm about nuts because I've been doing the same things all that long, but that's what I needed to do. I had to bore another group of guys all the time.
It always looked like it was the first time you did it, though, when we were out there.
Well,
maybe that's because...
try to use humor a little bit. Amuse myself. back to that one of, let me just, this was a question you asked me, Brian, back there. And, you know, this is something, probably the last 10, 12 years I coached, my last team I coached was 2009, and we had won our last 30-some games, and I gave it up. And there are two points here, I think that, number one, I knew I had a guy on my staff who could do this job. And so I did, and I know that other programs were looking at him, so I decided to step away while I still had him. And we did make him the new coach. And, you know, the first 4 years he coached, I think he lost 2 games. So he perpetuated the program because I knew, and what he did, and because, as I mentioned there, you know, we had a good foundation, he didn't try to change the foundation. The construction was different. You know, they wanted the walls painted and they wanted the configuration to, but the foundation didn't change. And that's why, you know, the program has continued, you know, to go on. Put back that one, back or up one, the whole idea. The point I want to make on this maximizing performance, you know, the whole thing, you know, became a big thing in our program. 1+1=3. Of course, the soccer players love that. They, you know, but a dumb football player, they can't have it. And, you know, the whole idea is the greater is going to, you want the greater more than the sum of the parts. And you can do that by creating that synergy. And the point I wanted to make, my last 10, 11 years as a coach, that's all I worked on. I left the offense, defense, I had other people to do that. And I wasn't that concerned about it because they weren't going to change what we had in place. But what I worked on was creating, because I knew that's kind of like the rule of the final inch. You know, 8-1, 9-2, 7-3, 8-1 again. we want to be, you know, or we're playing nine games, we want to win all of our games. And I felt when we really started to work and develop the whole concept of synergy and bringing the team to maximum function, that's when we really propelled ourselves. And then we went through and several undefeated teams in a row, and you know, we hardly ever lost. I think that was the key. And what that just played to our strength, because everybody had value, and we had a lot of people you know, who made this happen. And I really feel that was you know, what made the difference. There's no doubt in my mind. And it's funny, the first thing I would always do when I really got into this mode, around February, I get all the seniors who I know were going to be on our team the following year, and I used to invite them over to my house, and we were going to start our team building process. And I used to sit them all there in my living room and say, okay, of course they don't know what's going to happen. What are the problems on this team? Dead silence. Kids are looking at each other and like, yeah, I'm not offending you. I would say, I literally sat there, you realize how 2-3 minutes, how long that is, and you have a group of 12, 15 kids in front of you, it's like, you know, what's going on?
I was the one who made eye contact, and then it was on me.
And as soon as the first kid, Mike was in, I remember Joe Bach was another, as soon as he said something, then it's like, you know, the dike's open. Then you really got the, we got to know the problem, what the problems are before we can fix them. And so that was, again, a lesson. You never let these things go. You don't let them fester. You know, let's deal with small problems instead of big problems. I think that's good advice for any leader. Jump on things right away while they're small, they're very manageable, before you have a crisis and something you're going to lose control of.
Coach, what are the things, some or maybe one or two things in the last 10 years you were coaching, you talked about focusing on synergy, and that was what really transformed the results. What were a couple of the things you remember that were different about those last 10 years in terms of forming that synergy?
I think one of the things, I should have mentioned this earlier, that I was fortunate to have a great staff of coaches, and several of my staff members, the reason I hired them on the staff is they were outstanding classroom teachers. They could teach, and that's what we're doing. We have to teach kids. And so some of them never had any football experience, but you know, we could help them with that. And so I think that was one of the main things, that we had a group that just meshed well together, and they had a lot of the same characteristics that we were looking at. You have to. If you're going to motivate a team and you want to get a team a certain way, everybody who they're looking at up at the front of the room, they better be that type of person. Because with kids, and I'm sure with adults too, this just is not going to compute. There's something wrong there. They're saying this, but you know, I don't see that happen. So I think that's you know, one of the things. It's all pervasive.
Coach, I think this is a good time. We're going to play a little game right now.
Okay.
We're going to give you quotations. Some of them maybe you said. Some of them other coaches and you know, thinkers and writers have said. And you can try and guess who said them. And tell us a little bit what that quote means to you.
I'll be better on the second part than the first
part. All right. This, I'm going to lead things off here. First one is from a famous athlete right here in the city. The quote is, "There may be people that have more talent than you, but there's no excuse for anyone to work harder than you do."
Sweat equity, you know, and that's you folks know about that. That's why you're here. I mean, you can make up with a lot of failings by that. And I think that you have to believe in, you know, in my experience, I don't know what your experience is, and one thing I could do, I could look at kids and observe kids, and I would know who was really pushing themselves and who thought they were pushing themselves. And a lot of kids, I mean, they didn't feel that they were taking it easy, but they actually were. What they felt was, they would, hey, I'm doing everything I have. No, you're not. And so what do you have to do? You have to show that person. The best way was when we ran sprints at the end, I would put him next to the fastest kid. If you want to see somebody who really works hard, keep up with that kid.
Who do you think said that quote?
James New York athlete.
Lawrence Taylor.
That's a Derek Jeter quote.
Derek Jeter.
How about this one, Coach? Do your job.
Well, that's all we're trying to do. Do your job well. Again, you're dealing with a couple of those. Some people do the job, but they don't do it well. And I think, you know, as I try to explain it, always take it to the next step. In one example of my own career, there was a push at one time when I was a principal of the school. The board of ed wanted the principal to come to every board meeting. And all the other principals were going, great, we're going to do that. So we ended up not doing it. Then I started going to board meetings. You know, and the idea being to do this, I knew that that was something that was really showed them that, hey, you're willing to go to the next step. And so I think that you know, that's the whole idea.
All right, next quote. If you could kick the person in the pants responsible for most of your trouble, you wouldn't sit for a month.
It's hard to kick myself. I usually kick my wife. I think most times in most situations, you don't have to look further than looking in the mirror, finding out, you know, who's responsible. Because I really firmly believe you can control your own destiny. Things don't just fall out of the sky. You know, you're either going to make them happen or they're not going to happen. And that was a big thing. I mean, anybody who's been coached by me, I tell you that. What are you waiting for? Fall out of the sky, you know? It doesn't happen that way.
I lost my next quote. Brian, you're up.
Who said that? Yeah, who said that?
Coach, you know who said that? Famous U.S. president. Well, I guess they're all famous, but... Any guesses? No. That was a Theodore Roosevelt quote.
God damn it, Paolo!
Nate!
No, we talked about the importance of having of using fear and showing people that's not. And sometimes, you know, sometimes you get it, and sometimes you have to be stern.
Well, that's it. You know, fear is a motivator. It's like anything else. Though you overuse it, it's like some coaches scream everything. Does screaming have any impact on those kids? No, because that's the when I scream, kids knew. Because I rarely, if ever, did that.
Got right.
Next quote. It ain't over till it's over.
You're over.
Yep.
Well, that's it. You know, you never give up the fight, and I mean, that's one of the hardest things to teach kid, you know, I had this one slide there to like the stone cutter who's there banging on a stone. And it's on the 101st time he hits that stone that it finally cracks. And I would use that example to kids. You never know, you know, you never know. So you just stay with it and stay with it and stay with it. And you try not to get discouraged and you just keep doing it. And sooner or later, you got to believe that it's gonna work for you.
Hard work is a prison sentence without motivation.
Well, that's a good one because anybody you know who is motivated or has that type of energy, that, you know, it's like me. I mean, I the hours that I put in, it would never work. And I would hope that the kids that play me, I think a lot of kids that play for me, they look forward to coming to practice. They look forward, you know, I found that the tougher you were, the better they liked it. Because it was like the test for them. You know, I can, you know, it's like now, all this stuff these people do, like all these challenges and stuff. I mean, you know, there's crawling through muds and jumping on cliffs and so forth. You know, it's a challenge. I think there's an innate something inside of us, you know, where people want to challenge themselves and just how far can I go here? And I think that's what we try to offer, you know, to our team. Say, you know, we can do better than this. So one of the things I just want to explain is that I use, like we always had a meeting Friday night before a Saturday game, and they called it Sculpt, and it lasted 1 hour, and we never talked about football. We never diagrammed play or talked about our opponents. It was all things to kind of get their head in the right place. And one of the things we did, you know, we had, as the kids walked into the meeting room, I gave everybody a stone. And then when they got in there, they sent a kid around, and everybody put their, I had one kid put his stone in, and he's like whacking the table with the stone. Then I sent him around, and everybody put in the stone. Then he started whacking the table. Oh, what a difference. And you know, the concept that, hey, we get everybody involved, and everybody a part of this, you're going to do some serious damage.
Coach, talking about schools, at the end of each of those sessions, we would listen to a song called The Impossible Dream. Could you talk a little bit about the Impossible Dream and why you chose that?
Right, we kind of adopted this song, Jack Jones version. None of you probably know Jack Jones. The whole concept of the, you know, the impossible dream. And what I like about it is just some of the words in it. It's like one of the ones is to fight the unbeatable foe. I mean, what a great thing. Fight the unbeatable foe. Like, you know, you don't have any chance. He's unbeatable, but you're still going to fight him. And you're going to give, you're going to go out and give him your due. When your arms are too weary, you know, when you want to quit, when I can't go anymore, and we had this big expression all the time, you can always get up one more time. You know, I always preach the idea, you know, it's your mind that quits before your body. You always have one more left in you. You do 100 push-ups, you can go and do 110. And, you know, this is, you know, the mode you try to get kids in. And the other thing I like here, what the impossible dream says, this is my quest. And that's what it is, it's a quest. It's not about the victory, it's about the quest. And that's what our program came, because it was really a program about how you can be successful. That was the quest. And we didn't have to win every game for them not to learn that lesson. And that's the idea that you know, the quest is that the key thing. No matter how hopeless, no matter how far. In other words, one way or the other, we're going to find it.
Coach, just one question about that in terms of success. I think everyone in this room, regarding, you know, there's different ways to measure that. How did you measure yourself on success?
Like the people the kids became. And I could count on one hand, if that, the number of kids who I wouldn't want anything to do with. I mean, they all were my friends, and I would never hesitate to call on them. And I think probably one of the most gratifying things to me when you hear kids, high school-aged kids, talk to each other about, hey, love you, buddy, love you. And I think, you know, as you see adults do this, that, I mean, just a certain feeling about it that you touch something in. Because I think the idea of the whole synergy in a team. You know, it has a soul, it has a heart, and that's what a good team has.
Coach, in our final couple minutes here, you know, you've been doing this for 46 years. Most people here, they have to build a team in a matter of months or sometimes even weeks. What are the things that you want to impart to people? What would be the advice regarding things that you've learned over the past 46 years?
I think what you got to do is you always have to sell the message. Everything in our program wrapped around selling the message. Our locker room, when kids walked in the locker room, there was no doubt what this program was about. When I got up to speak at our banquet, there's no doubt who it was about. At a meeting of parents, there was no doubt what this program was about. Every meeting I had with kids would know what this program is about. You can never stop preaching. That sooner or later, you know, you have to, number one, you have to believe in it in order to do that. And I think none of you should underestimate your own passion and energy. There's nothing that connects with people, in my experience, more than that. When they see somebody that just, you know, hey, that they believe. And look at the passion. Look what they're willing to do. And I think that's, you know, so that gets people's attention. And I always feel that in order to move people, the first thing you have to do is give their attention. And you got to figure out what it is. How can I get his attention? How can I get his attention? What do they need? I give a couple others. I think another thing here is that as a leader, you got to give ownership to other people. People respect that, and they want to be trusted. And I think by giving them ownership, like in our program, the seniors were in charge of all the conditioning for the underclassmen during the summer. We hardly even showed up, the coaches, because I trusted the seniors. I gave them the parameters, and I told them what I wanted the end result to be, and you know what, they figured it out. And I think so, you give ownership. The idea of a team is it's like a we, but you've got to give people real responsibility and ownership. And I'm sure in your business, that's key. You know, like in the thing that they were doing before, you know, I'd like to be given more tasks. And I think that, you know, I can dictate playing time. I think as a manager, there are a lot of things that you can, you have a rising star, somebody you feel, hey, this person's really on board. I'm sure there's things that you can do that is going to send across that message to that person. I think that don't give all the answers. You want to people to figure things out. And I'm always telling people, you know, figure it out. You're great kids, you're great people. Sit down and talk about it. You can figure it out. And this is not splitting the atom here. And I think people have to trust in themselves that they have that skill and they can in fact do it. Modeling, which I'm sure you're very cute in on, that everything that you do is being evaluated. They're looking at you. How do they dress? How do they act? How do they talk to people? Everything that you do, you want to model the behavior that you want from your team, your crew. And I think that, you know, as I said, giving people real value, you got to have the energy to make sure you're finding out about people. And you know, you want to give them meaningful feedback. Whether it be criticism or whether it be, you know, praise, it's got to be meaningful. Not, they allude to not just, hey, great job with what? You know, but be very specific on what you did here. I think, you know, that rings with people. You know, they just, you know, sort of sit back and, yeah, I like the way this guy or this gal operates, you know, because at the end of the day, they want to be part of your team. They want to be led by you. And what you've got to do, your challenge is to give them the reason to do that.
Coach, on behalf of everyone, Brian and I just want to take a sec to thank you so much for being with us here today and for sharing what it takes to build a high-performing team. Every time I know we're with you, we're reminded of why we love being part of your team and why we seldom observe the synergy you spoke of earlier. In closing, I couldn't think of a more fitting way to end this session than how we ended every pregame speech or every Friday night before a game with a play in the impossible dream. And for those of you who haven't heard it, these lines will make a little bit more sense when we play. But once we play, the plan is every Friday night when we were playing, we would play this song. We would get all riled up and get all excited and we'd be screaming hard. And then we'd play the song and it would be completely quiet. And so our plan was to play this song. And then from here, especially I'm not going to say a few words afterwards, but we were going to just leave the room. And then I think the next step is we're going.
Bunch of grass, 7 o'clock.
Exactly. Something like that. So we will hopefully pull this logistic challenge off and play this song. I don't know if I have the right version, but I'm pretty close.
Listen to the words. Thank you.